I'm not super excited about class, not because I'm not happy to see you, but it's so much information, and it's all important information, so I'm going to be lecturing, like, almost the whole class. I know we'll definitely get through 1K for less than 2. So just get ready. But that's why I emailed you, for those of you who haven't checked your email yet, slides ahead of time. You have the information, and just trying to get through. Who stayed up to watch the final last night? Okay, so I admit I had kind of checked out, but then I saw they were going into overtime, so I got excited. So I'm like, oh, this is worth being a little sleepy for. I'll stay up and see. Did you expect the outcome being for Virginia, or do you think Texas is going to pull it off? You expected it.
Most of you did. Wow.
I'm so glad Michigan State's not in it. Is Demetri just never coming back to class? Wow. I'm absences. There's a couple, there's actually a lot that are like right at the break. I'm like, don't make me do it. All right. Let's go ahead and get started. So, any questions before we move forward? Okay. So, a recap of what we've discussed so far in terms of discovery. We have discussed the stages of discovery. The scope of discovery, which you might recall, is we discussed relevance and proportionality. And now we're going to turn to discussing mandatory disclosures, which has Rule 26A. So since we have a guest in the classroom, who can volunteer to explain what discovery is and why we are even bothering to learn about it? Anybody, what is discovery? Only once.
The fear.
Twice.
Elizabeth.
Hello. Not Emily.
Involved litigation, exchange information in order to build their cases.
Excellent. So, this is a reminder. We're trying to file a case in civil court. The attorneys have already submitted their pleadings, meaning their complaints to the court, and now both the plaintiff and defendant are in the discovery stage of litigation where they're exchanging information. So we're talking about the rules that regulate how that information is exchanged. So what are mandatory disclosures? Mandatory disclosures are disclosures that each party must make during discovery, even though the other party does not request them. So you don't really have a choice in the matter, it's just automatically you're expected to do these things. And essentially there are three types of mandatory disclosures that I have on the slide here. First being the informal mandatory disclosures, which I'll talk about in detail what that includes. All right, so let's talk about the first one, 26A1. It provides that unless a court states otherwise or except forth in 26A1B as a void, the parties are required to initially provide each other with four things without the other party having to request these four things. I tried to recall what those four things are.
I said it, I think if you come up instead of backward.
So that means anybody who's on a witness stand, you want to make sure you provide the other side with your card, like your hand card, so if you didn't plan on voting. Board information and any tangible things that the party has in the position to support their claim or defenses. So again, a copy or description, you can do a description by category or location, say if you're going to go out on the scene where the accident occurred. A documents, electronic support information, and tangible things the party has in their position. Again, if they made use to support their claims or defenses. For example, an action for review record. It's our actions to inform the arbitration award. So again, there are some exceptions, to the initial closing requirement, the closing requirement, and this is Rule 26A1B. Those initial disclosures that I just covered with you, the parties then require to make certain disclosures regarding expert witnesses. Okay? For a lot of emphasis, there's two types of expert witnesses. The first type is an expert witness, which refers to expert witnesses that are going to testify. Okay? The second type are consulting experts, which makes consulting for trial, but they're not going to test. Also referred to as trial preparation experts. is Rule 26. On your case, you probably should use the same question as the Meridian or Big Shot, but from Harvard on a big so-called case. You saw a lot of, there were a lot of consulting experts on the only decisions about experts on there will be on this cheating scandal, although I think Felicity pretty got it a lot of so surprised when I literally they were the deals. Why do you think the actress from Full House hasn't guilty considered have all the evidence? We got Martha Stewart double evidence, right? Yay. So it's two types of witnesses. So the required disclosures from Rule 26. A, that we'll discuss shortly, again, only apply to expert witnesses and not consulting witnesses. Consulting experts are governed by Rule 26B4B. Only tell me to know some headings of the report if you want to go look it up. 26B4B, what? So, Rule 26.2 provides that each party must identify any expert in the specific that we talked about in detail. It may use several rules of evidence, several. You'll want to find this evidence here specifically to support the condition that this is a two, unless there is to the contrary. The parties agree that each expert witness must prepare, stop, and submit a report on what they plan on doing. So 26A2, and 26A2B basically the details of what the the expert witness disclosure must formally be made 90 days before trial. As you tend to try to impeach another witness or contradict somebody. So, for example, purposes of civil procedure 1.2, we just need to know that if they're made 90 days before trial, that's it. But as always, of course, we can have a discretion. So if they want to vary this time frame because of some extenuating circumstances, somebody's in a car accident, a coma, whatever, the court can do that. And so, making sure I'm getting that. These are experts who are not
There's a lot of court people like. I was not there at the time of trials. I was finishing up undergrad, but they filmed it for me. And I didn't watch. It was certainly entertaining.
Okay, so I'm not gonna be a spoiler, but this is her hand. It wasn't scary.
We saw that.
It was pretty scary. It wasn't scary. Maybe because they hyped it up with the No, it was the advertisements. They're the trailers. It wasn't a bad movie, but I was thinking it's gonna be a nice little get out of it, wasn't it? And I wasn't scared. I don't want to be scared. And I went to see that IMAX at 12 o'clock so I could sleep. So I wouldn't be like making my head like my older Boogie Mouse during the puppet. And it wasn't even, it wasn't scared. They also know I wasn't scared. I couldn't wait for you to what good movies are out right now? Is it there? I'm
it's called, it's about a girl named Lisa who, gets the magic powers of this wizard, also named Shazam, the daughter of the name Shazam, gets him into the and it's looking actually quite fun, especially since the Disney movie started out really depressing for a no reason at all.
Yeah. full amount of the Chiquita case, right? At least they were trying to get access to the Chiquita International case that we'll be discussing. And I am moving quickly because I've already emailed you these slides. Alright, so, so we've talked about the initial disclosure, we've talked about what is required for expert and consulting. Normally, disclosure would be like a disclosure 30 days before trial, so twice the first. Each party was served at a before trial. Keep in mind that all the pleadings are done, all the motions have been ruled on, meaning all the pre-answer motions, the 12B motions have been ruled on. Various types of discovery have been completed. So it makes sense that you should be able to say with great finality to the party, this is ready for board trial, 30 days, discovery process is done, this is what we're bringing, the evidence that we're putting in front of. Party generally has 14 days to object to the content of the disclosure. Well, I know normally I'm supposed to give this information, but I'm going to give it because it's privileged. This is why. I'm going to back up a little bit and just kind of give you a long summary of what we just discussed with respect to the disclosures. Okay, so. So essentially, we discussed three important areas. Number one, 26A, the parties make certain conditional disclosures. Number two, the parties make disclosures regarding expert disclosure. We discussed that 26A2, the parties make disclosures regarding expert disclosure. Again, experts.
I'm sorry, before you go, can you just say the timeline real quick again? I got 90 days and 30 days, and I don't know where they fit for the, is it 90 days for the expert witness and 30 days for the...
30 days is
for
the
information.
Okay.
Yes, for expert witness.
So those are both the initial disclosures, though. Okay, so that would be kind of confusing on the exam, wouldn't it?
Okay.
have that information to the expert witnesses 9 days prior.
3 days prior to the trial, yes.
Trial.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
It has to be made and finalized though.
Well, yes, so things had a refrigerator, but essentially there's a lot of movement going on, so after discovery stuff you might say, oh, we need an expert. Something you can have a deposition to get you may not have to have a so Responding party must answer under oath or an example of a question about the interrogatory is call that in to use your microphone for space and April 1, 1967. A lot of the interrogatory questions are kind of just a short answer. Is it true that you're so if the responding party has to answer questions. injections, also with the answers. I administered the injection that I have, so it's a long time. I will give you 60 days as well. Going back and forth. That's it for interim. Thank you. Nothing yet to request for the session. Commit request. Rule 34 technically is titled production of documents and things, but they call it document request. Unlike depositions, interrogatories, asking questions and getting answers, Rule 34 requests are all about getting access to the document. Let's start with the definition. Rule 34 allows access documents and data, as well as access tangible things or land that are within another party's control if it's a land in the sense that they were hurt while they were
No, well, you can still be liable if you have a dangerous thing condition.
They are. I mean, they take their chances. They call this e-discovery, it's kind of a cool name. So in terms of remembering what you can ask for under Rule 34, case in the case, you can ask for it.
So is it 17-26B1 or is it?
It's part of. It's relevant to be. Perfect. Request can be sent to the cloud parties. Like in a lot of. Again, request for documents. Can be sent to both parties and non-party. But for non-party, we have to get a court subpoena. They're not part of the lawsuit, right? Tell them to give you the documents. So you will follow the court order, you're gonna get in trouble. So you do need a subpoena. You can say document request, whether it's. And that's governed by Rule 45. That's to compel non-parties to produce documents. Or tangible things that permit even a special purposes. Ask with interrogatories, the responding party in 3 days to respond to the document. So again, ask with interrogatories, the responding party has to respond to the document. There's a subpoena that is by the court. It was specifically tell the court when I'm going to say I was. Important thing to remember for the physical and mental exams. 2022. Again, for the purpose of issues 30.
Look more scared. Encourage you to go
and any objection must be stated. Guys, leave. And not to answer, but yet only when it's necessary to be privileged or any kind of user discretion. It's something that they see them should be safe away. Highly hard to be deprivation. You can't say no. Motion to terminate or limit the deposition. That's via Rule 15. During the deposition, a proponent or party may move to terminate or limit the deposition on the grounds that it's being taken in bad faith or abandoned by or oppressive to the someone's being a jerk. So then he gets in prison for contempt. in contempt of court, are willing to advise you. Why is court law saying that the defendant is going to have to do that information? Yes, please, thank you. And they said, look, this is privileged information. We're changing in our preparation for litigation. This is stuff we discussed in preparation for litigation, and you're trying to indirectly get my prior files, my attorney files. They're like, you can't do it. And they said, well, practically what you're asking me to do is to turn over not only complete files, right, but also telephone records and the thoughts of counsel, like my litigation strategy, like, and attorney-client privilege. So, sorry, what was the plaintiff's argument? Should get access to the materials? Well, the plaintiff says no. The defendant, you're wrong. You do have access to this, but for the time, there's no. Substantially equivalent to those materials that we have. time. So long as occurring repairs, material we can anticipate, litigation, and you have to fulfill that particular requirement. On the other hand, material that is acceptable in the ordinary course of business, right? Or other non-litigation purposes are not protected. So anything generated in the ordinary course of business, anticipating of using it at trial, is not covered. Additionally, a work product is not limited to material generated by a lawyer. Many people refer to what's covered by Rule 26B3 as attorney work product. It is accurate. If you're a legal that is working on your case, that is covered as well. So again, work product is not. Opinions or legal theories. If there's something to be considered, the testimony of the question about relevancy, proportionality, and privacy, mandatory disclosures, or the discovery. Yes.
What was
31. Oral or written. All right, so all we have left are the consulting expert sanctions. And I'll probably backpedal on the work product and kind of went through a little fast. Did anybody not receive the PowerPoint that I sent? All right, I'll see you soon.